Good evening, dear engineers. Welcome to the ISL lecture series on the professional review B paper that is being arranged by the membership department. I am here because I am in charge of the membership department as the president elect and chairman of the professional standards management committee, PSMC. So we, you must be familiar with this lecture series because this is this has been continuing for a couple of years now. As you are aware, these lectures are being organized by the membership department to help you to get some ideas on the aspects that are covered in the B paper, right? But that doesn't mean at all that the exam paper is based on this lecture series. It is just a guidance for you to know the topics that are generally discussed in the paper, right? And I think you are aware that the examiners are not the lecturers most of the time, so don't expect these lectures to directly help you in answering. It's not like a university where the lecturer teaches and then the lecturer sets the exam, right? So the by design, actually, we avoid the lecturers being the examiners. But then think of it as the advanced level, right? There is so much to learn. You know, you are given guidance on what you will be tested on, but then the exam is something that you have to use your own knowledge to write. Okay, so this is just definitely helping you in getting some guidance on the area, but don't for a minute think that the exam paper, the answer is there somewhere in this lecture. It's not the case, right? But then it will definitely help you because this is the type, because we try to get the best people in the country to give you the current situation on these topics, right? So it is a learning exercise for you. Whether you answer the B paper or not, it's going to be very relevant for your knowledge, right? So think of it that way, because B paper is just a hurdle that you have to pass. But when you are a professional engineer, you have to know what's going on in the country and in the world. So that's why we conduct these lectures for you, to broaden your knowledge, to understand what is required of a professional engineer and how to behave in the society as an engineer. Okay, so I will not take up too much of your time. We have an eminent engineer with us today, Engineer Nihal Somaveera. He has been, he is currently the secretary to the Ministry of Transport and Civil Aviation. Since 2005, he has been secretaries of various ministries, so he has a very good idea of how the government works. Governments work, because he has been serving several governments, and he started his life as an engineer in the buildings department, and then he has been working in the town and country planning department for several years, and after getting his charter and getting his master's qualifications, he has moved into the administrative side of engineering. So he is a very good source of knowledge for you. Make use of his knowledge. He will give you a lecture, and then there will be time for you to discuss any problems that arise. So this is an opportunity given to you. Please make use of the opportunity. Enjoy the discussion, and wish you all the best at the exam too.
Thank you, Dr. Mrs. Ratnakar, and good evening, everyone. Today, I will be speaking on the topic paper B on engineering society, and generally the area I will cover the transport, infrastructure in transport. Infrastructure in transport, although it says the road development, because I cover not only the road, rail, aviation, everything. So that is what actually I thought I must talk about the infrastructure related to transport. So here, as Dr. Ratnakar told you already, my lecture is not really focusing on your examination. Maybe in your day-to-day life, or maybe in your professional life, it will be very useful, where I'll be explaining you from the, I think, very basic things about the government system, and maybe subjects and function of various levels and various organizations, and what type of organizations under the Ministry of Transport, and the what programs and projects are ongoing in the transport sector, etc. So let me first start with this. Now, after your graduation, you will be working in the academic field sometimes, in the university or a technical college as a lecturer, or you will be working as an engineer in the public sector. Public sector means it can be a government department or government corporation, boards, and those are called semi-government organization, because the departments and the ministries are fully controlled by the government, and you will have financial regulations as well as the establishment code to control you. If you don't follow those things, you will be grilled at the FCID and various other places. So in the public corporations, you don't have certain corporations supposed to follow the FRNAR, and certain corporations will have some liberty, and they will have their own systems. Or else you will be working for the private sector, maybe as an employer or employee. Sometimes you will have your own firm, so you will be an employer. And usually in the government, we provide services to the public. So we are service oriented. If you are working for the public sector, you are delivering a service to the public. But if you are working for the public private sector as an employee or the employer, you are working mostly, your work is focusing on the profit. So you will be working on profit oriented basis. But really, in the government department and the government corporations, you are supposed to provide some service to the public. So ministries and departments, corporation boards, authorities, and other government-owned companies. So there are various type of organizations like that in the public sector. So public sector will provide service to the public, and the private sector will provide services to the government. So if you are working for the private sector, you take a company, maybe Workers Limited. So they will be providing services to the government or the another private organization. So their primary objective is making profit. So when you provide service to the government, either the services or the maybe the works, so those parties will be binding by an agreement. So in the government, you have to follow the transparent procedure in selecting a particular company for some services or the works. So in that case, there is a procurement guideline, thing called procurement guideline. So you are supposed to follow the procurement guideline if you are in the public sector. Even certain in public sector, even in private sector, they some companies are followed, but it is not mandatory for them to follow the procurement guideline. So they will have their own systems. Some may just handpick. So in companies, if they want to select some party for the construction, they just handpick, but that will be done by that highest level, maybe their board of directors. So they have that liberty. So basically, in your working environment, when you qualified as an engineer and if you are working in the field, either you will be doing planning or design or maybe procurement or financing or sometimes execution work, that means the contract administration, etc., and the operation and management. So those are the areas you will be working, either you work for the public sector or the private sector. Now, usually in the government, you have to have some understanding about the government system. So in Sri Lanka, we have three-tier government system. So at the center, you have the central government, and at the provincial level, you have the provincial councils, and at the lowest tier is the local government. So the municipal councils, town and urban councils, and the Rajya Sabhas are coming under the category of so-called local government. So we have a thing called the constitution. So in our constitution, so today I brought the 13th amendment to the constitution. So you have to understand how the responsibilities are divided among these three levels, just to understand how this governance system is working. So either you work for the private sector or you have your own company, you must know how the government system is working in this country. So you have a thing called a provincial list. There are three lists. Now you have three levels of governance: the central government, provincial government, provincial councils, and the local government. So under the provincial central government, you have various ministries. Now we have about 50 ministries, and under the ministries you have various departments and the corporations and the statutory boards. So that is at the central level. In the provincial council level, you have 9 provinces and 9 provincial councils. So in the constitution itself, they have given the, in the 8th schedule, they have given the names of these provincial councils. And in the same 9th schedule of the constitution, you have three lists. One is the central government list. The second one is the provincial council list. Third one is the concurrent list. Concurrent list means you have to understanding, you should have the understanding between the center and the province to implement that kind of functions. If there should be some cooperation between the center and the provincial councils to implement that kind of functions. If you take the subject of transport, the subject of transport is divided in the both list. It is in the central government list as well as the provincial list. So if you go by the real distinct wordings of the constitution, it says the provincial functions, provincial council list number 8, it says regulation of road passenger carriage services and the carriage of goods by motor vehicles within the province and the provisions of interprovincial road transport services. So
So those are the things coming under the provincial council. So the road transport, road passenger and the freight transport within the province is a function of the provincial council. And the under the central government list, we have the national transport. So under national transport, you have railways, and the highways declared under the law made by the parliament to be the national highways. There is a thing called, earlier it was called the Thoroughfare Ordinance. Now you have the RB Act. According to RB Act, the A class and D class roads are coming under the RBA. So those A, B class roads are under the central government for purpose of maintenance. And also expressways. Expressways under the central government. But the other class of road, C, D, E roads are coming under the provincial councils and the local government. And C, the carriage of passengers and goods by railway, land, sea or air by national waterways in mechanically propelled vehicles. So that is coming under the central government. If it is sea transport or the transport along the waterways, so that is the subject for the central government, not for the provincial council. And the air transport. So you have to understand that kind of, so we have a kind of a delegation of authority. So the provincial council get powers from the delegation of authority and they have certain powers. So without that understanding, actually you cannot work in this kind of environment, because earlier it was very easy before 1978, it was very easy. There's no provincial council. Everything is done by the central government and we have the local government. Two-tier type of governance. So there you have the central government and the local government. Now we have central government, provincial council and the local government. So now working is very, very difficult. You can see lot of protests are coming from the provincial councils against the certain bills presented in the parliament. They say it is not according to the constitution, so that is their function. So that is what actually, especially the, I think the various bills regarding the land matters. So land is a subject in the concurrent list. So there is a bit of ambiguity in that area. So that is what actually there is a lot of arguments going on between the central government and the provincial councils. Even the same parties in the power, there is a bit of misunderstanding between the center and the provincial council. So then I'll go back to the transport. Under the Ministry of Transport, we have 8 agencies. The Department of Railways, Sri Lanka Transport Board, National Transport Commission, and Department of Motor Traffic, Transport Medical Institute, Civil Aviation Authority, Airport and Aviation Services Limited. So now I'll go one by one. I think you all know the functions of the Department of Railways. They are in charge of the operation of railways in Sri Lanka, and they have a monopoly. There is no other organization, only Sri Lanka Railways can operate railways in Sri Lanka. And it gets the authority from the Railway Ordinance. It's a very old department. And the next is Sri Lanka Transport Board. So it is a state-owned bus company. So in the transport sector in Sri Lanka, the public transport
is mainly road-based. 95% of the public transport is road-based. So there, we have total of around 30,000 buses in Sri Lanka, and 25,000 is belongs to the private sector. And CTB, Ceylon Sri Lanka Transport Board, has roughly around 5,000 buses. So the Sri Lanka Transport Board, they manage those 5,000 buses, and they operate between the provinces and within the provinces using those 5,000 buses. And the National Transport Commission, so that is the regulatory authority under us, the regulatory authority to control and manage inter-provincial transport. Because the provincial transport within the province is a provincial function. So we cannot do any regulation or monitoring of the provincial bus service except CTB. CTB is directly under us. So we can manage the CTB, but we cannot regulate or manage the private buses. So it is the functions of the provincial council. So if you have any complaint regarding a private bus flying from Colombo Fort to Borella, you will have to make a complaint to the provincial council, not to the transport ministry, because that provincial bus operation is not under us. It is under the respective provincial council. So there is a Western Province Provincial Transport Authority controlling the, regulating the private bus operation in the Western Province. So in the National Transport Commission, they regulate inter-provincial bus service. If there is a bus service from Colombo to Anuradhapura, so provinces cannot operate. So then that bus service has to be regulated by the NTC, National Transport Commission. So the private buses operating from Colombo to outstations, other provinces, has to operate under a permit issued by the NTC. So that is what you see on those buses, the emblem of National Transport Commission, and they have given the contact numbers. For any complaints regarding those buses, you will have to complain to the National Transport Commission. And Department of Motor Traffic. So that is the department who register the vehicles and issue the driving license. So they are supposed to do the registration of vehicle like our birth certificate. To birth to death of a vehicle, they are supposed to maintain the register, but unfortunately they are not doing it. So even yesterday I had to face in the parliament public accounts committee lot of complaint against this department, lot of malpractices. So they are actually, we are proposing to use IT in the future, and there is a project called e-motoring project. So finally we will implement e-motoring project, so there will be lot of online facilities there. You don't have to personally visit the motor traffic department to get certain things done, so you can do lot of things online. So that e-motoring project, so we are working with the assistance of the ICTA, the agency, government agency in charge of IT development. So we are developing that document, and we'll be calling requests for proposals very shortly. And we have done the EOI process, is passed now. We have pre-qualified about 5 or 6 firms, and we'll be issuing the RFP to those firms, and they will be designing the system, IT system software for the implementation of this e-motoring. So with that, we'll be connecting, this department will be connected to all the divisional secretariats, insurance companies, and customs. So they, when you import a vehicle, you from the customs you will
directly get those information to this website, this system. So you get system generated document. So no one cannot change those documents. Now there are a lot of allegations against the department. Department is changing these documents. Certain officials, corrupt officials are changing. So due to that, lot of complaints are coming to the ministry now. So it's a very important department, and it generates lot of revenue to the government and provide lot of services to the government. So in time to come, we are going to implement a different kind of a driving license, especially drivers who are driving the public vehicles, bus transport and private buses, even three wheelers. They are supposed to get the public transport license. So they have to mandatory go through some training procedure, that is to reduce the number of accidents. And also we are going to implement the demerit system in the driving license. If you are actually not, your driving is not so good, actually you are repeating those bad practices, so someday you will be, your driving license will be cancelled. So there is a point system, and someday it will lead to temporary cancellation or permanent cancellation. So we are going to implement such a system with the replacement of the new driving license card. And the other organization is the Transport Medical Institute. So this institute is supposed to issue the medical certificate for the drivers. You know the present driving license issued by the Department of Motor Traffic. It is valid for only eight years. So I took this license in 2010. So it expires on 2018. So I'll have to go to the medical test and get the new driving license. Every 8 years you're supposed to renew. So here you have a chip here. So the police officers will be provided with the reader, and they can read various information in the driving license. So this is to implement this, we included this thing to implement the driver demerit points. Unfortunately, in 2008 although the technical the system is ready, but the legislation was not ready. Even today we are having the discussion with the legal draftsman department and the justice ministry, modality of implementation of this demerit system. So the Transport Medical Institute, they have their headquarters in Nungegoda, and they have branches in various districts. So they carry out the medical test leading to when you want to get the driving license renewed or the new driving license, you have to first go through the medical test. So they are the people who does this medical test. And the next organization two organizations in the aviation sector, Civil Aviation Authority and the Airport and Aviation Services Limited. Civil Aviation Authority is the regulatory authority who controls the civil aviation, and they go by the ICAO. There is a international organization called ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization. So they have developed a lot of regulations to regulate the aviation sector. So they go by those regulations, and basically they are the regulatory authority. If someone wants to start the flying school or local aviation service, they have to get their permit from the Civil Aviation authority. Even the pilots will have to get their permits from the civil aviation authority. And Airport and Aviation Limited, it's a public company, fully owned by the government. So they are the people who manage Katunayaka and Mattala International Airports and Ratmalana Airport. That is the only only airport, the local airport, we have the civilian flights. We operate civilian flights. And we have 15 such airports in Sri Lanka. All are controlled by the Sri Lankan, Sri Lanka Air Force. And even Ratmalana, they have control over 85% of the airport. And we have control only 15%. So with that, we are managing the civilian flights with the cooperation with the Sri Lanka Air Force. Well, we have several private operators. In addition, Sri Lankan Air Force also have a wing called Heli Tours, and they operate military airplanes for they use it for commercial operations, but they don't follow this. They are not supposed to follow the civil aviation regulation. So most of the tourists, they don't like to fly in the military planes operated by the Sri Lanka Air Force, because they know that since they are not covered with the those regulations, so anything happens, so they are personally liable. So the civil aviation authority, the civilian operators, has to follow the regulations imposed by the civil aviation authority. And then, so you are secured with the private operators. So now we are going to take over another airport, Batticolo Airport, from the Sri Lanka Air Force, to start operation of the local aviation. So there is a lot of demand there. So lot of hotels have come up on the eastern coast, and lot of tourists are going. But they have to go by the roads, and they have to spend more than 7-8 hours on the road, and therefore there is a lot of demand for local aviation industry to develop, especially focusing on those areas, especially Palale, Batticolo, Trincomalee and Sigiri area. So those are the organizations under the ministry. So I'll briefly explain what kind of projects and programs are ongoing in the ministry, especially in the railway sector. I think I made this time in the Institute of Engineers the lecture on this Rampal Memorial lecture. So there actually I collect lot of information from the railway, starting from early 1960s to date. So there, in 1965, during Mr. Rampala's period, we had 300 engines. Railway department had 300 locomotives, and that time we have the population of 12 million in our country, and very little urban population, and lot of people, they used to go to the school nearby, and they never came to Colombo for medical treatment. So likewise, actually the number of trips generated also very less. So that time, even in that time, we had 300 engines. Today with over 20 million population, and nearly 30% urban population, and lot of migrating population coming to Sri Lanka, Colombo, today we are operating with 180 engines, just 180 engines. Out of that 180 engines, majority is over 30 years old. So there are frequent breakdowns. So we must thank the railway engineers managing with this kind of rolling stock. So I think the last batch of locomotives brought to Sri Lanka Railways in 2000, year 2000. So we brought about 10 engines, Alstom engines, but unfortunately those engines are highly high-tech engines. So out of 10, only 3 are working today. But I think the first set of GSL engines brought to Sri Lanka, I mean those engines were called M2 engine, the second batch of diesel engine, was brought in 1952. We got 13 engines under the Colombo plan, free of charge, it's a grant, 13 engines. Out of that still 12 is running, perfectly running. So one was destroyed by the terrorists. The other 12 engines are still perfectly running. So the priority for railway is to upgrade the rolling stock. So that is the topmost priority of the railway. So we must have more engines, more compartment, and more freight wagons to improve the public transport. Because when you develop the road, you are not promoting public transport. So majority is private modes in the roads. Roads, 70% road users are private, not public. But if you do the railway track, it is 100% public because it is public transport. So unfortunately, after independence, we have never given any priority for the railway sector. That is what has happened, and day by day, it has gone to that stage, and today entire railway infrastructure is at a very deteriorated stage. Not only rolling stock, signalling, there are frequent breakdowns in signalling, and even the track work. And unlike in the road sector, you need 3 times the capital to develop railway. So if it is road, it is only the road surface. So you develop the road surface, maybe you do some embankment and some structures and then the road surface. But especially railway, if you are doing the railway, you have to do the structures, you have to do the embankment, you have to do the surface, and you will have to lay the track, and you will have to do the signaling, and you will have to bring the rolling stock, and you will have to run. So it is very costly. So after independence, we are now implementing our first railway project, new railway project from Mathura to Beliyattu. It is a really big struggle, really big struggle. So the design speed of that railway is 100. 100 kilometers means if you have to run at 100, you can't have so many curves, and you have limited vertical alignment. So the speed control the vertical as well as the horizontal alignment. So in that case, there will be lot of land acquisition and lot of cutting and filling. If you are from that area, you must have noticed, to construct the Beliyattu railway station, we are doing a 15 meter fill. We are doing a 15 meter filling. So we are shortage of gravel there, because actually you need a huge amount of material. So because we cannot change the alignment, but the I think the railway developed by those British people that time, the speed is very low, maybe 30 or 40. So at that speed, you don't need such a stronger track, and the engines are lightweight, and today the engines are heavier than earlier. And if you have to have more profit, you will have to go for more heavy engines and more heavy, longer trains. For that, you have to have a very strong track. So only track in Sri Lanka today we can run at 100 is, I think, beyond Kalutara up to Mathura, and beyond Omante to KKS, or Omante to Kankasanture, because those tracks were designed for 120 and you can run at 100, permissible speed is 100. But in all other tracks, we have lot of speed limitations, especially the area between Polgahavela and Polgahavela, especially Kurunagala and Anuradhapura, is very weak, and we are monitoring daily. There are so many derailment on this section. So still we have to replace the those wooden sleepers by concrete sleepers. So the replacement of sleepers alone won't help, because we have to strengthen the sub base. Then only, actually with the strengthening of sub base only, you can have a perfect section. So you can see, if you have traveled up to Jaffna, you can see the travel between maybe from Polgahavela, if you pass Kurunagala to Anuradhapura Vavuniya, that section is very bad. It is very bumpy and you get lot of noise. But if you pass Komante and beyond, you don't get any noise. It was like riding in a railway in a foreign country. So it was very smooth, because the track was done, it was perfectly designed and built to some standard. Of course, if you are doing that kind of construction, the cost will be slightly more, because cost is proportional to the quality. If you have you cannot compare the cost of development of railway by the railway employees and that kind of international company. So there will be a difference, cost difference. So now the railway, our top priority is the replacement of this the rolling stock. So now we have several programs. Now we have Indian line of credit. Under Indian line of credit, we are going to buy few engines and the diesel multiple units, so called power sets. So already we have gone through the procurement procedure, and now we have signed the agreement with the Indian company called Rights to supply these locomotives and the power sets. Of course, we had a lot of complaints regarding the previously supplied power sets from India, because appearance is very ugly. One thing, because everybody comments on the appearance, appearance is very ugly, and some fittings are not really good compared to Chinese and the Western. But the cost wise, actually it is cheaper, but those quality problems, we had lot of quality problems, and this time we have had detailed technical negotiation with those terms, and we have pointed out you cannot repeat those mistakes in the future supplies. So accordingly, now we have signed the agreement with the Indian parties. But the thing is, that we are asking for a tailor-made product to suit our conditions. So they have to design and manufacture. So that will take 2 years. So although we have ordered and the agreement signs already, it takes nearly 2 years to supply those locomotives and the diesel multiple units to Sri Lanka. So in addition, those Indian engines and the locomotive, the DMUs cannot run on the upcountry. Upcountry situation is worse. So that is actually very rare kind of situation in the world. We have few railway lines like this, upcountry railway line, like in places in Chile and the Tibet. Because highly mountainous area, and you get lot of curves and lot of I think vertical alignment, very steep alignment. So you have to have a different kind of engines and a different kind of bogies. Bogies means the underframe of the railway carriages. So there actually we have had a separate tender, worldwide tender, and we have called tenders, and we have got lot of offers, and there we have selected one company called GE, General Electric from USA. Although their price is bit high, so they are the only technically qualified bidder. So we'll be having the world famous GE locomotive, if government can borrow government can borrow, because government will have to borrow from the bank. So the borrowing capacity, so we have a problem at the moment. So we have to, I think, since this is the high priority project, so we have to convince the government that we need the engines very early. Then we can have a very good railway service between Kandy and Colombo. Because today you see, if you go by the road to go to Kandy, you have to spend nearly 4 hours. If you go by rail, intercity, you reach Kandy in 2.5 hours. And very safe. So that is what actually we are trying to develop, the railway service between Kandy and Colombo and Badul. And anyway, between we cannot increase the speed beyond Gampola, Navalapitiya to Badulla because of the terrain. So it will be for tourist attractions, not for real day-to-day transport. It will be for tourist attraction. But Colombo to Kandy we will be developing, and Mathale will be developing. Colombo to Kandy, Mathale and Gampola will be developing the railway passenger transport. So that is what actually we are now looking for, the new engines. And the second priority for the railway sector is the upgrade of the existing tracks. So we have had discussions with the Asian Development Bank, and they are in agreement to provide the financial assistance to develop the urban railway system, to develop 158 kilometers within the Western Province. So we will be making maybe certain places double track, certain places triple track, and we will be developing the signaling and upgrading the railway track, and finally we will be doing the electrification between this Polgahavela to Panadura, and on the Putlam line up to Nigambu, and maybe Kalinveri line. So there, under that project, we will be developing the Kalinveri line, we will be making it double track, and we will have, I think, a better service in the Kalinveri line with the double track. Today we have a lot of limitations there, because you know it is going through a tunnel of houses, almost touching the doors of the railway carriages. There are scooters on both sides of the roads up to Gomagala. So you have to remove those scooters, and they are illegal occupants, but they are there for generations, so we cannot just send them out. So we have to have some relocation housing program, and even up to make it double track between Maradana to Kota Road, you have to relocate nearly 400 houses. So there you need about 1.6 billion rupees to relocate. So now we are having a social survey on the Kalinveri line to identify number of families and their problems, and then we will prepare the relocation plan to relocate them elsewhere and to develop Kalinveri line to make it double track at least up to Padukka, and then there will be extension from Kottavu to Horana, so it will connect the 120 bus route. So at the moment there are 7 routes coming to Colombo. If you are coming by road, there are 7 roads, and out of those 7, only 4 is covered by the railway. So we are going to make it 6. So there will be railway line extension from Kottavu to Horana, and there will be railway line. I think you must have heard about the Sapukaskanda refinery. Earlier we had a railway line, it was abandoned, and already I think the people, they have encroached. So we are going to develop that up to Pugoda. So there will be a railroad, a new railroad going there, other side of the railway, other side of the Kalani River. So that will be a new corridor parallel to the low line road. So we will be covering 6 railway carriages in the Western Province. So that is actually the programs coming under the railway. In the bus sector, now we have our plan is to manage the state-owned buses, around 6,000 buses, and give some kind of a because otherwise in case of a crisis situation there will be a monopoly if you allow only the private operator. So it happens actually one day last year there was a bus strike and finally rail CTB was able to manage and they provide fair service during that day. So we have to keep I think CTB as a government organization, and for that government is paying a very high price. So government subsidies a huge amount. So every year government spend nearly 14 billion to maintain the CTB. So in the bus sector, so we have to make the CTB more profitable. So for that now there is a restructuring program going on for the CTB. So we have 10,000 excess employees, we have 36,000 employees in the CTB and 10,000 more. So those 10,000, none of them are drivers or the conductors or the mechanics. Mostly every change of government, every government, they fill CTB, all clerical or other kind of labor kind of employees. So the CTB is overburdened with this kind of political employment. So today we have 10,000, so we are going to remove. And luckily I have good understanding with my Prasanth minister, he is not prepared to put even a single person to the CTB. So under that understanding, now we are going to create a cadre for the CTB. Even in the future, no one will be able to put their own people into the CTB without, I think they have to follow the procedure. They have to advertise and get them in. Otherwise, no political employment will be possible in the CTB in future. So we are going to do that. Because otherwise, again, it will fall back to the same position someday. So today, the position is their EPF, ETF was not paid for years, and we have to settle 11 billion rupees to the ETF and EPF board as arrears. So there are a lot of court cases. So every day there are warrants issued by the various courts to the CTB chairman. So he is hiding now. He cannot come out now because there are a lot of warrants issued by the courts. And we have to get this money from the treasury, and little by little we are settling that. So during last 1 year, now we have settled fair amount and we brought it down to 6 billion, there is. So finally when you retire, you cannot get your ETF and EPF because they are not big carriers. So that is how they have managed the CTB. So they were trying to manage the expenditure, not sending the deducted money from the employees for ETF and EPF. So they were managing to run the buses. So we are not doing that now. So we have specifically instructed the accountants not to do that in future. If you fail to pay the statutory dues to the ETF board and EPF, you are liable. You are personally liable. So that is how actually we have stopped that. Now the accountants cannot do that. So DGM Finance will have to go to the jail in future if we continue to do that. So that is the situation in the CTB. And CTB with the restructuring will be getting the card approved by the treasury. So it will be brought down to 25,000. So per bus, we are going to bring down the number of employees per bus to 4.5. So presently it is around 6 or 7. So we will bring it down to 4.5 and then we will make it profitable, and then without burden to the government, the CTB can manage their own operation. And we will be introducing the ticketing machine, and there is another procurement. Now we are planning that procurement, electronic card payment system, with the assistance of the ICTA. So we have to first develop the payment platform, and then any operator can issue the cards. So you can buy the card from any place, like today the telephone, like telephone card, and you can use it for the public transport. So you will be making payment direct from your account to the CTB account or the account of the private bus operator. So you are not giving money to the conductor, so conductor cannot keep the change money, and there are a lot of malpractices are happening today, and CTB is losing averagely 20%, 10 to 20% of their income due to these malpractices by the conductor. So in future we are going to 100% stop that kind of malpractices, and to get the 100% income to the government, CTB. So that is our plan for the bus transport. And the aviation sector, and the motor traffic department, our plan is to implement the e-motoring project and make the paperless transaction. So at the today, when you go to the motor traffic department, if you want to transfer your vehicle, or if you want to the new vehicle transfer to your name, you have to make an application. So paper application, and you have to wait in the queue. So if you want to do it in one day service, you can do it. But what they do is, they develop a separate file, because they cannot find the original file of that particular vehicle. So they develop a new file and they do your transaction within one day. But they don't have a proper record on the vehicle. So they misplace that file also. When you want to transfer your vehicle to another owner, so again they create another file. So that is how their present system is not satisfactory. So we want to make it paperless. So in that case, even from home, you can get your, the vehicle transfer. And today, you know, in the provincial council, you have a good system to revenue license. You can get it on, get your revenue license online. You can make the payment online and you can get your revenue license. You don't have to go to, the Maligavat, the provincial motor traffic department office or the divisional secretariat. So you can do it online. So similarly, we will make most of the services online. And today, you know this in the passport office, although you are supposed to fill some forms, they return all the forms to you. So they have a very electronic database. So they don't have to keep those records anymore. So we are going back to similar system in the motor vehicle. I think in the aviation sector, there are a lot of developments, and Civil Aviation Authority. So we are buying a lot of equipment for them to, monitor. Because you get a lot of income. It is a money spinner to the government, the aviation sector, and you are getting some income. Even the overflying planes, if they don't even land at Katunayaka or the Manthara, you will get some income, because overflying, you are providing certain services to the international aviation. According to the international aviation law, you can provide certain services and you can get some income. So we are getting some income. So for that, you need lot of modern equipment. So we are buying those equipment now. And airports. Now in the Katunayaka airport, now the present runway is, their warranty period is over. And we are about to get the final notice from the International Civil Aviation Organization. They can terminate that international airport status. So we are about to get that, and then we went for cash program, and we have selected a contractor and the international consultant, and now we have started that relaying of the runway, and it's happening now. So every day between 8 o'clock and 4:30, we are closing the airport, and we are doing, we have only 4 hours of working. So first 2 hours you have to prepare the thing for the construction, and then you have to do the construction 4 hours, and you have to prepare for the landing for the next 2 hours. Only you have to work 4 hours a day. So with that, actually we'll be targeting to complete that work by the 6th of April. So we will have a very modern and runway with the taxiways. And at the moment, you don't have facility to land 380 aircraft in Katunayake. You have to do a lot of preparation before landing. Only you can do emergency landing, because you have to shut off the two turbines on either side, because it is going to the unpaved area. Then only you can land it on Katunayake runway. So with the present repair, we are going to widen the runway, and then without any difficulty we can land. We have facility to land 380 aircraft after KPL. So that is actually an emergency repair we are going doing at the moment. So that will be financed by the, so we are getting a loan from a private bank. So the Aviation Services Limited will be repaying, and on a government guarantee. So that work, I think majority, I think 75% of the work has been completed now. So we can, I think, finish the relaying work before the due date, I think 6th April. I think by end of April, March, we'll be able to complete that work. And the second other important project is expansion of the terminal and the apron, the parking areas for the aircraft. So at the moment we have the capacity to handle 6.5 million passengers annually, and at the moment we are handling 8.5 passengers. So that is what actually you see a lot of congestion in the airport. So you have to go for immediate expansion. So we have got the JICA loan. Under JICA loan, we have already awarded one contract. The package B is the expansion of the apron area. So the package A is now under the, I think, tender process. So we'll be completing that work by end of July. End of July we'll be completing. So we hope that by August this year, we'll be able to start work on the new terminal building. So now we have about 8 aero bridges, and we can park only, we can provide the service for 8 planes on aero bridges. So others are bus gates, so you have to operate the bus from the aircraft to the terminal building. And that takes, actually that is a bit risky, and on the other hand actually there can be a lot of delays. If we have an aero bridge, the passenger can go right up to the plane. He can walk right up to the plane. So at the moment we have such 8 gates. So with the new terminal building we will be developing 16 more. So we are increasing the capacity 3 times. So with that we can handle 20 million passengers annually. So we are going to start that project by early August this year, the construction. So the entire development will be completed by 2020. So those are the some of the projects and programs undertaken by the Ministry of Transport. And when you take the transport sector, it is not only the Ministry of Transport. Well, I mentioned that this is a transport is a function partly done by the center and the provincial council, and certain powers are with the local authority also. If you study the municipal council ordinance, the Colombo municipality has powers to handle their own transport. So that is how During early days, I can remember during my childhood, Colombo had a very good tram car system. So it was operated and managed by the Colombo municipality. And those days, the roads were very clean and roads were washed daily, no dust on the road. And nicely landscape and less congested, and you get very good public transport. And all double decker buses are running in Colombo, and you have a tram car system also to go from place to place. And today the system, none of those, I think the tram car is taken off long ago, and we cannot go back to such a system now due to the lack of space on road. Either it has to be elevated or underground, but to do that kind of a system is really costly. If you are going for light rail transit or monorail, it will cost around $50 million per kilometer. So that is, we have a big affordability problem there. Then if the government cannot afford to borrow, the other option is to go for either BOT or PPP project. So BOT, none of the private sectors will come if they cannot recover their investment within a reasonable time frame. If they cannot recover the investment within maybe 15 to 20 years time, they will not come. So how many of our passengers can afford to pay such a big sum? If you have to go to maybe Bhattaramulla from Colombo, you may have to pay about 200 rupees or 300 rupees as a train fare. So how many of our public servants can, I think, afford to pay? So that is why we must develop the conventional railway. But you have to have that kind of a system for the car owning population. So for that you have to implement park and ride concept. So they can come in their private modes and park their vehicle somewhere and get into this type of public transport and come to various places. Unfortunately, today we don't have a reliable transport, public transport. So that is what actually it's very difficult to get the car owning population to the private public modes. So as I mentioned earlier, the transport is highly fragmented, and we have four ministries working in the transport. In the central government itself, we have four ministries handling the transport. We have Ministry of Transport and Civil Aviation, and we are the policy level organization. So we are supposed to develop the transport policies. And now newly created the Ministry of Megapolis Development, Megapolis and Western Development. They are in charge of the transport land use planning and the transport planning. So that is the planning work is now coming under the purview of the Ministry of Megapolis. So they are now developing a megapolis plan for the western region, and under that they are preparing a transport plan. Because this transport and land use plan has to go together, there should be good integration between those two planning. So otherwise you'll be wasting resources. So that is what actually that planning powers also has gone to that ministry. So Ministry of Megapolis and Western Development is in charge of the planning. In addition, we have Ministry of Highways and Higher Education. I don't know why Higher Education is together. Ministry of Highways. So they are in charge of the development of highways, the construction and maintenance of highways. So under them, the A and B class roads and the development of expressways are coming under their purview. And Ministry of Ports and Shipping, because the port and shipping also part of transport. So Ministry of Port and Shipping, so sea transport is coming under the port and shipping. So that ministry is another ministry coming under the purview of transport. So in the central government we have four ministries: Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Megapolis and Western Development, and Ministry of Highways and Higher Education, and Ministry of Port and Shipping. So those are the ministries in charge of the subject, various subjects of transport. So we have to work very closely with those line ministries and the provincial councils to have a proper transport plan and the programs. And even in the implementation, we'll have to have a very close relationship. Otherwise, there will be duplication and misunderstanding. Especially it happens generally in the area of bus transport, because today some of the provincial councils, they issue permits for the interprovincial transport. So then finally the inspectors employed by the NTC, they catch those buses. So they have to have, if you are operating between provinces, you must have a permit from the NTC. The provincial permit is to operate within the province, but not between the provinces. So likewise, today we have a clear division, what is the provincial council role and what is the central government role. Even within the central government, there are various organizations like several ministries, and there are several agencies under those ministries, and especially the Urban Development Authority and the Low-Lying Area Reclamation Board is under the Ministry of Megapolis and Western Development. And if you take the RDA, the organization like RDA and other Maganaguna, those are under the Ministry of Highways, and Sri Lanka Port Authority is under the Ministry of Port and Shipping. So that is what actually the subject of transport is highly fragmented, and there are a lot of programs, ongoing programs in various ministries for the development of transport. Similarly, Highways Ministry also having so many programs. So they have programs to construct new highways, new expressways. So we know now three expressways. Now we have completed the Southern Highway and the expressway from Colombo to airport, and the Outer Circular Highway. I think nearly 50-60% of the Outer Circular Highway is now completed. By 2020, they will be completing the balance portion. And with that, those two highways, the Southern Highway and the Expressway, Southern Highway and the Airport Expressway, will be connected by the Outer Circular Highway. So we will have an interconnected network of expressways after implementation of the Outer Circular. So in addition, there are plans to develop a highway to North, highway to Kandy, highway to Ratnapura, but maybe we may not have the government funding for all these highways. Maybe we have to go for some other methods like the PPP or the BOT kind of arrangement for implementation of those projects. So then finally we have to carry out the feasibility, and we have to convince the funding agency that these projects are feasible on BOT basis. So likewise, there are programs to develop the Colombo Port. Now Colombo Port has come to 24th position in the world, I think, container transshipment as its hub port, and we are doing most of the transshipment in this region. And we are going to develop the eastern terminal of the port, and there are government is willing to, I think, go for PPP arrangement to get a private sector operator, like in the case of the southern terminal. So there will be private operator coming there and operating. And even the southern port, the Hambantota port, there are a lot of potential to develop Hambantota port. because to come to the Colombo level, it will take another 30-40 years, and you need huge amount of investment. So our government cannot afford to, I think, get that amount of investment. So we'll have to get the private investor. So now the government is now trying to negotiate with Chinese company to give it on 80-20 basis, and there are certain arguments. We should not go for 80-20, we must go for 65-35. But if you go for 65-35, you will get less upfront payment. If you go for 80-20, you will get a good upfront payment. I think government is willing to get a handsome amount at the upfront payment, because government will have to set up the loan, because otherwise 90% of our income is going to repayment of loans today. So we cannot borrow anymore, because if you have to develop the infrastructure, you have to borrow. You don't have that capacity within the country. The treasury cannot find money for everything. Your treasury get money through various taxations. So you cannot increase the taxations. If you increase the taxes, so there will be some negative effect. People will not invest in Sri Lanka, even the Sri Lanka. They will invest elsewhere, where the tax benefits, they get tax benefits. So our own entrepreneurs, they will go out from the country and they will invest elsewhere. And the foreign investors, they will move away. So there will be less investment. So there is a limit, actually, you can increase the taxes. And that is the direct taxes. Indirectly also, you cannot tax the people, because there is a certain limit. So if you tax too many also, then there are negative effects. So there will be a lot of inflation in the country. If you borrow too much, too many loans, if you go for too many loans, and there will be a lot of inflation. So it happens in the countries like Yugoslavia. You must have heard about Tito, President Tito. In 1960s, there was a president called President Tito in Yugoslavia. It was one country at that time. Now there is, in Yugoslavia, is splitted into five countries. Because I have been there for 3 years, actually. I was studying the earthquake engineering in Yugoslavia for some time in 1990s. So during that time, the $1, morning one rate, afternoon another rate. So you need a gunny bag to carry the cash. So they gave us allowance in Yugoslavian dinars. So you have to have a big bag to carry the your allowance. Because $1 is 30,000 dinars. So there is no value of local money. And they develop a lot of infrastructure in the country. So if you see that country is very developed. The infrastructure is developed, but their economy is not that developed. Because you have to develop the infrastructure in far with your economic development. So there should be that is what we call sustainable development. If you go for unsustainable development, you will face with that kind of problems. So you will have balance of payment problems, and you will have inflation problems, and then the future generation will have to suffer. So that is what the present government will have to, I think, control the borrowings, and they'll have to go for other methods of financing, like BOT and BOO and PPP. So now there is a separate unit set up in the Ministry of Finance to develop documentations to go into that kind of new concept of financing, project financing. So with that, we hope there will be a lot of projects for the transport sector also. But definitely now those projects are happening in the telecommunication sector, lot of PPP projects, and you see lot of telecom operators are here. Now they are more, I think, popular than the government operator to take the telecom sector. But there is a lot of development. During our young days, we had to wait years and years to get the telephone. I was in the waiting list for 3 years to get the telephone, home telephone. Now today, the operators will come behind you to promote their own product. So that is what today within couple of hours you can get the telephone connection. So similarly, we'll have to develop the other sectors also. The power sector and the transport sector is very important, because it is very important for the economic development of the country. So that is actually, I gave you the very brief I think description about the governing system of the country and what will be your role when you go to the field, especially the industry. You will have to work within a system. So this government system, although you are in a private company, especially if you are running your own organization, if you are an entrepreneur, you must know all that. Then only you know where your business is. And especially if you are employee of the private sector, you will know where the projects are happening. Then only you can, your company can apply for that kind of thing. You can win the tenders, and you must know where the work is. And the future programs of the government are still in Sri Lanka, majority of the, I think, projects implementation by the government, except the buildings, housing and building. So there are a lot of, I think, condominium development happening in Colombo. In the building sector, yes, there is a lot of private sector projects in the building sector. But in other areas, mostly the infrastructure, the projects are government-funded projects. But in future, there can be private sector projects if you go to the those innovative other financial borrowings like the systems like this BOT and the PPP.
So I think that is actually very brief introduction to the transport sector and the government system and the role of the Ministry of Transport and the agencies under the Ministry of Transport and the ongoing projects and programs. So if you have any questions or any clarifications if you need, so I am there to, I think, answer you maybe another 10-15 minutes. Okay, thank you for your patience. Thank you.